Good evening, all, and welcome, welcome, welcome to BookHampton, RJ Julia Booksellers, and Wesleyan RJ Julia Bookstore's virtual event featuring the wonderful Simon Doonan. We are so thrilled to have you all with us. Before we get started, just a few quick Zoom housekeeping details to go over. Please ask questions using the chat box function of your Zoom screen. We will get to as many of your questions as we can later in the evening. And though you will remain muted throughout the duration of the event, an RJ Julia staff member is monitoring the chat box, so send your questions on over. For optimal viewing, you can use Zoom view functions in the top right corner of your screen and select speaker view so that the speaking author is highlighted throughout the duration of the event. If at any point you should get disconnected, fear not. Simply re-click the event link emailed to you earlier today and rejoin. We will be monitoring the waiting room to admit you back in. And of course, don't forget to purchase your copy of How to Be Yourself, Life-Changing Advice from a Reckless Contrarian. Links for book purchases will be sent to you in your Zoom chat box. Friends, we are in for a great treat tonight. I am absolutely honored to introduce to you the fabulously talented Simon Doonan, writer, media personality, former Barney's creative director, and star of NBC's Making It, who joins us to discuss his new book, How to Be Yourself, a book that Amy Poehler calls a cheeky, kind, and vibrant look at what it takes to shape your one beautiful and wild life. Simon worked for Diana Vreeland at the Costume Institute before joining Barney's New York in 1986, where for nearly three decades, he was the creative director behind the store's legendary displays. He lives in New York City with his partner, the ceramicist and designer, Jonathan Adler, and their rescue terrier, Foxy. We are also thrilled to have with us tonight, Wendy Goodman, who will be in conversation with Simon this evening. Wendy is the author of The World of Gloria Vanderbilt and, with Hutton Wilkinson, of Tony Duquette. She has been New York Magazine's interior design editor for 20 years. Goodman's career began at Harper's Bazaar, after which she went to the New York Times Magazine and House and Garden, revealing the worlds of style and fashion. So, without further ado, please help me in giving a warm digital screen time welcome to Simon Doonan and Wendy Goodman. Take it away, Wendy.
Well, it is my great joy to be here and an honor to be with my friend Simon, who is just the most, I mean, Simon is just pure joy. And I have to tell you that in these days of so much that we're going through, this book, I've read it twice now, and because of its perfect size, you can carry it with you all the time and just go through it and cheer yourself up and laugh out loud. It is so divine. Simon covers an Emmy nominated show, let's just say, okay, I'm adding that, Simon, how your show is Emmy nominated. First of all, Simon does deserve to have the fun that he has because he also spreads his joy all over for us. So this is the great thing about Simon's genius, part of his genius. But the book is really interesting because you read it the first time and you're laughing and you think this is so funny and true and right. You break it down to different sections, style, people, love, work, and it's spelled W-E-R-K. Decor and family, and then conclusion. Now, the thing that you mentioned in the introduction, Simon, is that you started the book thinking it was sort of a reaction against social media. And it was that, you know, we all get so lost in this virtual world with FOMO, fear of missing out, among many of the other diseases we catch with social media, as good as it also can be. But you really make a point in the beginning of the book of saying, you know, it's important to reconnect with yourself and instead of being in that virtual tunnel, to connect with people, go out, da da da. And as I was reading it the second time, I thought the thing is, of course you wrote this before the pandemic. And now that we are all locked into our screen lives, which is our only life, really, I just want you to talk a little bit about that aspect that you write so brilliantly about in the beginning of the book and what we're going through now.
Well, the things in social media that I found a little concerning, more and more I saw that people were being forced by social media either to be incredibly self-critical, because social media is a world of thumbs up, thumbs down, or to focus on things that were way in the future. So you hear on social media, people talk about dreams. You've got to follow your dreams. And I've always been very suspicious of dreams. I think dreams are just nightmares, but with better furniture, you know? And I think that social media talks a lot about bucket lists. You know, people, oh, I'll put that on my bucket list. Don't put anything on your bucket list. Do it all immediately, now, tomorrow. Don't wait. Life is short. And I think, during the pandemic, I think you hear that a lot. People say, oh, life's short. Obviously, you can't go bungee jumping now because it's too cold, or it's not the right time because of the pandemic. But basically, it's about not dithering and deferring on everything and jumping in and getting on with it. And so, I thought if I do a self-help book, it has to be through the lens of humor. And I'm always inspired by the sort of very bossy people like Diana Vreeland from the 60s, 50s, 60s, who were very like dictatorial, like, you know, take your Aubusson rug to a waterfall right now and have a picnic. You know, I always thought those were really fun. Obviously, she doesn't quite mean it, but she kind of meant it too. You know, the idea of just getting on with life and having fun. And for me, I, above all, believe in not being self-critical. People shouldn't be self-critical. They should be accept themselves, love themselves, magnify themselves. A lot of my other books have had that message. So.
Yes, exactly. Well, the other thing is to sort of be very kind, as you say, and realistic with yourself, because the whole part about style is kind of, it's not about beauty. You emphasize it's not about beauty. It's about owning it, whatever it is. And I think that, you know, you talk about how one's hair is a sort of signature. You can, you know, you've got all these elements within yourself to play with. I mean, personally speaking, my hair has tortured me every hour of my life. And that is why I'm wearing this hat. But so I read the book and I was thinking, right. I mean, you know, Mrs. Vreeland very famously honored the fact that she was not a beauty in the conventional sense, but her whole philosophy was make the best of what you have and own it.
Yeah, and it wasn't through the lens of fashion. I tried to stay away from fashion as much as possible. That's why I included people in the chapter about how to look like yourself. I have people in there like, Samuel Beckett or Robert Mueller. Yes. The Mueller Report, or people who really seem to have figured out how to look exactly like themselves. So I wanted it to be a very inclusive kind of idea of how to look like yourself. So Nick Offerman is in there as somebody who really looks like himself. Susan Boyle, you know, Simone de Beauvoir.
Yes.
So it's not just about, I wanted to get rid of fashion can be very confusing and off-putting to people. I wanted it to be about, well, Diana Vreeland said, I loathe narcissism, but I adore vanity. So I think, you know, developing a sense of your own look requires conviction and sort of introspection. You know, it's not about following trends.
But on the other hand, the interesting thing is the ability that we all have to role play through choices in fashion. And then we'll get to home decor because you have a great chapter about decor. And so I was thinking as I was going through it again, okay, what's the difference between like finding your style and going, okay, this is it. This is my uniform. This is what I'm always going to be wearing, as opposed to, or maybe including, I can change this every day. I can pretend I'm, you know, Lois Lane today. I can be Marilyn tomorrow. I mean, which would be sad, but where's the balance in between role-playing and your authenticity?
I think in your teens and 20s, you should be trying on roles and having fun, and one day be super butch and the next day be super femme and really go all over the map and have fun with it. And it's a sophomoric period. And then you find as you get older, you sort of end up with a particular range of looks that are, you know, when you look in the mirror and you've got your stuff pulled together, you look like yourself. Like Iris Apple said, there's nothing more horrifying than looking in the mirror and not seeing yourself.
Yes, yes. Because then, I mean, if you can't inhabit yourself, you're nowhere, actually.
Oscar Wilde said, you know, you should be yourself because everybody else is taken.
Yeah. Well, your chapter on decor is really fantastic because basically you give this you know, image of meeting your cool friend, Angie. And then you think she's so cool because she's so put together and she's so fabulous looking. And then you go to her house and it's a sad, sad place where there's no effort been made. There's no sort of exploration of what feeds you and makes you feel good. And it made me think so much about the experiences of going into people's homes I've had this that I think they're the most glamorous, most, and then you see that at home, their most personal place, they don't exactly take care of themselves or honor themselves, and that's very revealing. So
yeah, I think it's very relevant to the whole pandemic situation because we're all at home, so we have all this time to look around and think, wow, you know, like the home business is the one business that's kind of booming right now. Because people are looking around, buying new pillows, buying paint, painting a wall, zhushing their home up because they realize, well, yeah, it is a bit depressing. I need to make some kind of effort. Not to compete with the neighbors, but to just really, you know, take that idea of self-expression and extend it into your home. I'm always amused, you know, when people's homes are very dissonant from them, you're right, it's very jarring. Like if somebody's, you know, got some dough and they're, you know, swanky kind of people, and then you get to their house and it's too austere and minimal and they're not having any fun, it's not relaxed. That's sort of jarring. Like what's the point in the dough if you're not gonna, you know, chillax? And I'm a big believer in relaxing at home. I have that whole thing about lounging.
I love that.
You know, you have to. Winston Churchill said, never sit where you can stand, and never stand when you can sit, and never sit when you can lie down. And I think people are able to be themselves when they're sort of lolling and lounging.
Yes.
And I encourage people in our house, when groups of people come to our house and they stand around, I'm like, no, sit. I'm always pushing them over, lie down, lounge.
Right.
I think it's much easier for people to be themselves if they're prone.
Yes, it's
true. That sounds a bit awful, doesn't it? But I think it's true.
Well, I think that, you know, you as a host being comfortable, welcoming people in. I mean, I know that everybody who visits you has the best time of their entire life. I mean, I don't worry about that. But, you know, on the work scene, you also, you know, you say something really interesting. You say, I found Barney's and Barney's found me. It was sort of the absolute perfect marriage because this was a job that wasn't really a job. It was a calling. You created windows that were literally the moment of the year that we'd all wait for to see what you do. I mean, on top of everything else you did there. So it was.
Yeah, I was very lucky. It was serendipitous kind of thing. And I met Gene Pressman and he said, oh, we're expanding, we're opening a big women's store downtown. And suddenly I went from, you know, being a kind of feral person working in LA, living in LA. And suddenly I had this job in 1985. I was actually hired and I started in 1986. And I was working at this glam store and working with people like Andre Putman and Peter Marino on the design of that store and meeting all these designers and seeing new lines arrive like Prada and at its inception and Jill Sander. And, you know, I was so lucky. And it was during the height of the AIDS epidemic. So my non-work life was dealing with people who were dying and thinking I was dying and going to hospitals to visit friends who were dying. And then I had the ultimate distraction, this incredibly absorbing job in a family business. So, you know, we were there 8:30 in the morning and we were still there at 8:30 at night because the store didn't close till 9. So it was one of those jobs where it was completely absorbing. And all the great people that worked there, Glenn O'Brien, Ronnie Cook, you know, Doug Lloyd, like it's endless, all the fun, great people. So it was, Gene Pressman always said, I want to create a Bauhaus, you know, a new Bauhaus. Yes. And he kind of did, because, you know, people remember the windows, but the ads were incredible. That Ronnie Cook oversaw, and Glenn too, and Paula Greif before that. There were all these great people that sailed through there. And so we were all so lucky to be part of that, because Barney's was, we were able to be completely unconventional, because Uptown was still carriage trade. Remember carriage trade? Yeah. Like Lord and Taylor and Bergdorf's, and it was all chandeliers and kind of posh. And downtown, we could invent a whole new idea of fashion and retailing, where, because we were in this unconventional location and the rules sort of didn't apply to us. We never went uptown. We didn't know what the hell was going on. So we created our own thing, and it was great. I was so lucky to be part of it.
Oh my God.
RIP.
You know, it did create a benchmark and a new sort of level for retail that we'd never had before. I mean, you reinvented the wheel as far as that goes. The book, you also go into an amazing, I think the family chapter is incredible, because I think all of us grapple with our inheritance. And I'm talking about our inheritance of our families and how, excuse me, how complicated and how layered, and you know. So I think what's really the most wonderful takeaway for all of us in all of our lives is to understand that even if things are really, really difficult, if there are family members that have tortured you, have whatever, we all have it in us to rise above it and to create. You know, you said something wonderful in the book about you wanted so much to get to London because you knew that you could rebrand yourself in London. And, you know, your mother, you just watched your mother and how she kind of navigated life and how she, you know, your mother and your father. And it's sweet and it's honest and it's forgiving and it's, you know, you're filled with pride. But it wasn't always easy. And the thing is that I think the more people understand the inheritance is something we all struggle with, it's a really important lesson for just feeling good about yourself and also going on your own path.
Yeah. Well, I think, you know, getting to the point where you accept your family as flawed human beings, and, you know, Coco Chanel, she once said she had a very difficult start in an orphanage, and, you know, she bootstrapped it. And she said, my life did not please me, so I created my life. And, you know, growing up in the austerity of the 1950s and then becoming gay in the 60s when it was still illegal to be gay and, you know, facing those kinds of things, I approached it like a la Chanel, like my life didn't please me in my little industrial town, so I created my life. And that's sort of what people did back then. It's a kind of Holly go lightly thing where you go to the big city and you create your life. And now I'm very envious of young kids because they have fantastic relationships with their families and they're constantly in contact with them. And they're texting them and they're loving, I love you, and declarations of, and I think that's great. That's sort of.
Whoa. Don't know. See, I don't know how to not make that happen, but anyway, we'll pretend that didn't happen.
Yes. No worries. So, I think it's great now that people do have these more concrete relationships with their family. One didn't have that back then. You had to do, if you were gay, you were whatever, you had to basically go and create your own life, you know, and build it from scratch. And there's a certain satisfaction, and you get to the city and there's a whole bunch of other people doing the same thing. Yeah. I think up until very recently, I remember, you know, London in the 60s, 70s, 80s, you know, these people like John Galliano, Alexander McQueen, they were kind of reinventing, Vivian Westwood, you know, she was a school teacher, but she reinvented herself as like an incredible creative force. So I don't know, I hope young people, I'm sure they're still able to do that, but they don't really need to do it with such kind of those savage kind of breaks where you just, you know, run to the Trailways bus station and disappear. Now they have a lot more communication with their families. So I think that's very healthy. I missed out on a lot, you know, by leaving and then emigrating to America on my own when I was 25. You know, it's later on I realized, oh my God, I have to make an effort to reconnect with my family. And I was able to do it to a certain extent, but I have a lot of regrets mm-hmm. about not being able to do that, you know, with my mother in particular, because I was just off doing my own thing.
Yeah. Well, again, every generation, it's all relative to what we have in our lives technologically, I think, because of course there's instant communication. And back when we were youngins, it wasn't quite like that. You know, it was pre-internet when I started my career, I'm just saying. So, you know, nobody, young people at the magazine go, what? Like, had they invented fire by that time? But the other thing that you talk about at the end of the book that is so key and so important is your conclusion. You talk about, you know, now that you've kind of grappled with yourself, you've come to terms, you've really sort of went, you've gone through all this, then, wait, I have to look at the exact way you put this, time to unself. Would you unself, and tell us about that whole process.
Well, I thought we've spent all this time now talking about oneself, yourself, myself, how to be yourself. And then that isn't really the end of the story. And I quote Iris Murdoch. Iris Murdoch was such an interesting writer. I don't know if you've... I tried reading her books when I was young and I couldn't get through them. And then I got back into them in late middle age and they really start to make sense because they're completely bonkers. But anyway, she was very clever. She was a blue stocking, you know, and she looked like herself, very much so.
Always.
Kind of very intellectual, existentialist, blah, blah, blah. But she came up with this idea of unselfing. And she said she realized it one day, she was in a snit about something. Somebody had insulted her or made a dent in her prestige. So she was staring out the window, you know, when you're obsessing about something someone said to you, and she watched this bird of prey, a kestrel, and she watched it soaring and going up. And then she realized she was unselfing, getting out of herself and stopping, you know, some silly introspection that wasn't going anywhere. And so she also believed that, you know, that thing where every novel is really about the author kind of thing. She didn't believe that. She thought it's an author's obligation to get out of themselves. And to, she said, some authors lay around and splash themselves with their own bath water all the time. And she didn't want to do that. So she came up with the idea of unselfing. And then I also cite this thing I read about in National Geographic called group effervescence, which is very relevant to now. Like something... The sociologists studied these mass religious festivals in India where there's literally millions of people congregate suddenly, quickly, over three-day periods by the Ganges. And they walk from their villages and they stand in cold water, which is often has bacteria in it, and they don't eat anything. And you would think this would be a disaster, but they return to their villages and their physiology is improved by some miracle. And the only thing the author could attribute this to was this thing called group effervescence, the enjoyment of the group. And I think that's what people get from sporting events, rock concerts, green markets, you know, like we need to congregate. So currently we're deprived of that. And I think I'm glad I got to stick that in at the end, because I think that's something everyone's going to need to top up their group effervescence. Because just that, some people say, oh, I hate crowds. And I'm always a bit suspicious of that, because everyone has walked into like a football stadium or something where you've got that, you thought, wow, look at all these people, 60,000 people. Yeah. It's an incredible feeling. And I think it does have some bizarre physiological impact. So yes, self. And then at the end, remember, you know, you don't want to become one of those people.
Right.
It's a little reminder.
Well, that brings me to the question of, since we are social animals and we do love to, we get, like when you go into a restaurant, there's all that buzz and you know how restaurants are designed to let you look at the people with mirrors or however they do it. And there, and I really think you're so right. There is this excitement about being with your social peers, your animals, your tribe, whatever. But because retail has had such a terrible trauma, will we go back to the experience of, you know, part of the fun of shopping was going into a store and looking at things and seeing the people around us? But that doesn't seem to be something we're going to enjoy anymore, do you think?
I think, you know, human beings are so protean and they're so adaptable. And I was just in LA and there's nothing much you can do when you're working on a TV show. You can't take Ubers, you can't dine with anybody, you can't, you know, you have to really obey all these instructions.
Yeah.
So the one thing that me and my co-star, Dana Ison-Johnson, we would do would be go hiking. So we would hike up to the Hollywood sign, that area, and because we could get there from where we were staying without taking any transport. And up in the hiking trails, there are people, and the joy people have of just trotting around, not, you know, definitely socially distanced, but just great. There's people, look at all these people, people with their kids, people with their dogs. And it start, you really have a new appreciation for that vibe that you get from being with a whole group of people.
So
come back in different ways. In other,
yeah,
other ways.
It's so true. Well, just, and this is apropos really of nothing, but just something I was thinking about facing yourself. I mean, I think that as far as, you know, we're a country where aging is, it's a very tricky situation for men and women to be in a society that has put so much pressure on people to look great and to look young at all costs. And I was thinking about, you know, if I had only realized, and I think young people today do feel it much more, but youth is its own beauty. There is not one person who isn't fantastically interesting and wonderful looking. And I don't want to be ageist as I'm older and say, oh no, it's just young people, because that's not true. I think you do pay attention and you really sit up looking at someone who goes, I am who I am. You know, I think of Vanessa Redgrave and I think of Meryl Streep and I think of, you know, who just really look, as you say, look like themselves. But I don't,
you know what Andy Warhol said? And Andy Warhol said, if everybody's not a beauty, then nobody is. Meaning, that's why he was able to see beauty in, you know, these drag queens from the street, and a bit like Diane Arbus photographs. I think she saw beauty in all those people. Absolutely. So if everybody's not a beauty, then nobody is. So I always think that's such a great thing. And I think he was very self-critical of his own appearance, but I think he was expressing something that he kind of wanted to be true, you know, that's how people should regard things. And I tend to see things that way. I think people are just fascinating, all shapes and sizes. Absolutely. And I love to go to the public beach and see all people lolling about, having fun. You know, all shapes and sizes. It's great. It's very life affirming.
Well, I do think we have become more liberated and less, you know, coming from a fashion background, you know, we now are much more accepting of, you know, body types, differences. You know, it used to be back in the olden days of my youth and all that, it was very different. And now I think there's much more accepting of it. And I
it's a revolution. It's a revolutionary change in the last year and a half. I mean, to my credit, I'm going to pat myself on the back.
Please.
I used to say, why aren't we carrying larger sizes? Because I see women buying jewelry and scarves on the main floor who are dying to, you know, get into some ready to wear. And then there was back in the 80s and 90s, there was this real sort of brick wall against expanding sizes, and all that's gone away now. Like the size inclusive thing has gotten real traction, and you see it in Vogue, you see it everywhere. That's a big change. And I think it was a long time coming. So we should celebrate it though.
Absolutely. And do you think that when we get out of this pandemic, that it will have changed us in very sort of fundamental ways when we reemerge, and will be more forgiving as a society? Or is that, am I crazy to think of that, you know?
Well, I think, you know, like something as dramatic and global as that, some people will be driven completely crazy by it and never recover. And other people will take away really constructive, positive things. And other people, it'll be a mixture. I think for me, it's a mixture. Half of me is traumatized and half of me is like looking forward to the post-COVID era and how that shapes together, because I'm an optimist about humanity. I believe people figure things out, they reshape things. I think it's going to be a mixture. To answer your question properly, it's going to be a mixture of all of the above. I mean, you know, people say, oh, scar tissue makes you stronger. I don't know. Sometimes it does, and sometimes it really does you in.
Right.
Like, there's no guarantee with that.
Yeah, it's so true. Well, I think that we're going, I mean, I've been reading a lot about the Second World War for some reason. And, you know, it's not as if we're going through things that the whole history of the world has not gone through. Mankind has suffered mightily through, you know, that's just the state of humanity in the world. So this, we are going through our own particular thing, as is everybody around the world. But I think a book like yours brings a kind of, I won't say levity, but it puts things into perspective from your own personal point of view, but also from a point of view of someone who really understands the culture and the scene. And, you know, you have been so spread out across the boards in fashion and decor with you and Johnny and just doing all these fantastic things. So I think I sort of think this intimacy of what we're doing right now, I've never seen people so literally as in these Zoom things. I mean, it does bring a new intimacy that we didn't have before with people in some funny way.
Absolutely. And people, you know, trying harder to be empathetic about what other people are going through. No, the Second World War, as you were talking, I was thinking about, I was born not long after the Second World War ended, and all the adult men in my world had either fought in the First World War or the Second World War, and they were all had PTSD, and they were all threadbare. Nobody had any money, and they'd all suffered horribly. And these were the people that had made it, you know, like had not died or perished in a concentration camp. So, I thought that when the AIDS epidemic came along, okay, this is our test.
Mm-hmm.
This is our test to see if we can retain our humanity throughout this ordeal and remember how horribly people are suffering in India or Pakistan or, you know, Bangladesh or Africa, you know, how people might be suffering in other countries. While we're worried about our banana bread burning, you know, there people have terrible issues they're dealing with.
Well, I have to say, I mean, also your show Making It, I mean, now that people are stuck at home, everybody is sort of hungry for things to do, especially with their hands, to make things, to create things. So, I mean, the fun that you must have on this show is beyond belief.
I mean, absolutely. I mean, the reason it's a hit is because people are trapped at home with their kids looking for things to make, do, you know, so yeah, it's very constructive. Like my husband, as you know, Jonathan Adler, the potter, the ceramicist, he said there's been like a stampede towards ceramics in the last year, people are always emailing him like, I've taken up ceramics. And he's like, he's delighted, because when he was first doing it, it was still considered a bit of a joke, you know, like it was like, he and I both kind of had these joke professions. I was a window dresser and he was a potter. Well, everybody else was going into finance or, you know, we had these funny professions. It was a bit like being a fluffer in a strip club, you know, it was a little bit on the margins. And then it became groovy. He was the first Brooklyn hipster potter. But anyway, yes, making things with your hands.
But the other thing is, Jonathan is so the quintessential sort of success story, because he started with pottery and of course now has a design empire. So it just kind of, he organically grew his love for design, for tactile beauty, into an empire.
I know, it's extraordinary. I mean, we just had our 26th anniversary. And when I met him, he had just basically gotten an order from Barney's. That predated our relationship. I just want you to know that he didn't shag his way into Barney's. So that's 26 years of vicissitudes have gotten him to this point, you know, where trying licensing deals, trying this expanding in retail, and then having to contract again. And I think, you know, he's an expert on what it takes to hang in there and be nimble and be flexible and resilient, you know.
Absolutely.
I don't know why anyone in fashion or home goes into the designing, manufacturing, distributing, wholesaling, retailing business, because it's a total nightmare. I mean, I'm so lucky I had a job for all those years. I thank the Lord. Like, anytime you're putting zips in things and shipping them and sizing them and having pattern cutters try to get them the right size, and the pants go before the jackets have gone and they have to come back because they won't take the pants without the jacket. Like, those businesses where you're making stuff is a complete cauchemar.
Yeah, it's really hard.
Yeah.
I asked you, this is your 8th book, Simon, which is so phenomenal. And it's like you're just a book factory at this point. Are you working on another book now?
I have another one coming out in spring on Keith Haring.
Oh, how wonderful.
That was fun to do. The thing is, I'm always very, I have to be busy. I have to be busy. And my job kept me busy for over three and a half decades. Yeah. So I have a huge amount of energy. I get up every morning and I think, what am I doing today? So books are great for me because I can, pound them out. I did a book on the history of drag. I did a book on soccer players and their Lamborghinis and their wags and their designer handbags. I enjoy like new topics like that. Like that was where I had to do a lot of research. This book was so fun to do with Fiden.
With Fiden. Fiden is amazing. And is
major.
It
major?
Yeah. And is it the first book? I mean, this it probably isn't, but yours will be very special. From about Keith Haring. It's another look.
Oh, the Keith Haring book is with Lawrence King Publishing. Okay. In London. And it's one of a series of books about artists. And they said to me, do you want to do the Keith Haring one? Because you were in New York at that time and remember him. And so they said, we want 30,000 words. So I read everything that had ever been written about Keith Haring and kind of regurgitated it into a book. It took me like 2 years. And it was so fun. And I have a new appreciation for him. Because we all, those of us in New York, you remember him and, you know, you're very clear about what he did and when, but there's a lot there that's so impressive. Anyway, I don't want to, but that's next spring.
So you've already done it. You finished that book.
Yes.
And you're working on the one after that, I bet you anything.
Well, I'm always sort of lobbying proposals at book publishers. That's how I got this book at Fiden. I went in to meet with them. I proposed a whole bunch of books and they basically gave me, you know, they were like, oh, right, yeah, that's great. We think you should do a book called How to Be Yourself. It was my editor, Deb Aronson and Sarah Bader. They had this idea. It was their idea. And I went away and I thought about it and I wrote up this proposal and first chapter, and they looked at it and they said, every single thing in here is just carved out of your observer columns that you wrote. We want original material. How dare you give us this book? So it was very good because it pushed me, and I had to really dig into the idea of what does it actually mean to look like yourself, to be yourself, you know, to get a more engaged take on it rather than just collaging a bunch of tips from my old observer columns, which I'm very proud of, but they weren't having it. And I'm very glad they pushed me. And so, that's how it came about. It was the publisher's idea and I ran with it.
And how long did it take you to actually write it?
A year and a half.
Yeah, okay. That's a good amount of time. That's fair time.
Yeah, and lots of rewrites. And they were very good prodding editors. They were like, this doesn't make sense. No one knows what you're talking about. No one's heard of this person anymore. Like, they were very good. I respond well to that. I'm quite obedient. Yeah. I like an editor that gets very granular with me.
Are you going to do, I mean, this is a really dumb question, but since you can't do real book signings, are you doing, can one do virtual book signings? How are you going to do this?
What one does these days is, and what I did for my drag book, even which was before COVID, it was last year, The History of Drag, podcast. Because people who listen to podcasts invariably are people that buy books. It's actually a fantastic way of marketing books. And it's very green. You don't have to schlep all over the place.
That's great.
Podcasts are fantastic for the publishing industry. And they're fun to do. They're informal. You know, you don't have to, like I'm wearing the most absurd pair of swim shorts with this sweater. You would never know.
No, you wouldn't. I think we're going to have to do a segment at one point where everyone has to show what they're wearing beneath the desk, because, you know, people, their slippers, their pajamas, their whatever. I mean, you know, people just, they're dressed like that.
Absolutely. I mean, these are the shoes I'm wearing today.
Excellent.
Yeah, little leopard loafers from CVs.
Okay, well, there you go.
Shout out to CVs. They're great. And they have them in women's sizes too. Okay. They're very comfortable.
Well, that's another thing we could do, a show and tell of all of that. But I know you've got questions. I know I'm not supposed to go into your question time.
We do. We have some questions rolling in here from our fantastic audience. If you'd like to take some of those now. And the first question is actually for the both of you, Simon and Wendy. What's been the number one source of joy for you during this pandemic?
Mm. Wendy? Ladies first.
Okay, well, I will say very honestly, events like this, seeing my friends, even if it's through a screen, and actually engaging with people is my biggest sense of joy. And also, I am extremely lucky to do the work that I do, which puts me in touch with people constantly for the magazine. So my sense of joy is, you know, connecting with my family and my friends, however I can do it. And just being grateful for every second and everyone that I love is, you know, and just seeing how much you can do to help people, you know, around you in any kind of way. I mean, that makes you feel better if you can help them.
I guess the first thing that sprang to mind with me was, I like to take our dog, Foxy Lady, and lay her on her back and massage her until she's just in a lull state. And then I cut her hair with clippers and scissors and trim her little panties, you know, make her very hygienic. And I stare at her and I say, I love you so much. I adore you. And she looks back at me and it's the same expression. And so I think dogs, to me, I love dogs. And Jonathan, I talk about this in the book, the metaphor for how to have a good relationship. You have to treat each other the way you treat your dog. Always happy to see the other person.
Absolutely.
You're never complaining and saying dire things like, well, is this muffin GMO? Is it organic? You know, dogs never ask questions like that. They just eat it. So dogs are fantastically, intrinsically optimistic. And so dogs are a great source of joy, but they're also a source of inspiration.
True, very true.
Well, and that's a follow-up question too. One of our viewers wants to know, how do you fill your cup and create fun throughout your day? So I know you've spoken a few ways that you do that with reading and your work, but animals are a big part of that as well.
A big thing for me is putting on a little outfit every day. You think, oh, I'm not going to see anybody today. Well, you might. The window cleaner might suddenly appear in the window. And I think I'm a huge believer in that. At some point, you know, to be bathed and perfumed and throw on a nifty outfit, I think is a big source of positivity. It's very life affirming. You know, we've all had friends who've gotten depressed, and the first thing happens is they start to look terrible and disheveled, and you can tell they're sad, you know. So I think actually throwing on a nifty outfit, okay, you've got that Saint Laurent something that you paid a fortune for hanging in the closet, put it on, like, and do your Zoom calls with it on. So, like, I'm a big believer in, when I emigrated to America, I didn't have much room. Remember, I'm 25 years old. I had one little suitcase. So I left all my sensible work clothes behind, and I only took my party clothes. And I was very happy in LA. I just wore these crazy glam rock party clothes all the time. So yeah, just have a few weeks where you just wear your party clothes. Everyone will appreciate it. People love it. It's very, not only is it good for you, but it makes other people feel good.
Yeah.
Or they'll think you're insane, you know, which either way.
It brings a smile. So let's see here. Please share a key point on love for us, Simon.
Oh yeah, Simon has a good chapter on that.
Yes, I think, I refer us back to the canine species because they really do know how to be very loving and engaged without being demanding. It's funny, they just have this magical way about them. And Johnny and I have a great relationship, and our relationship is very much like two Labrador dogs who are just sort of used to banging into each other and ambling around the house. And, you know, sometimes I hear friends of mine getting into a spat, like, oh, you're not listening to me, honey, and blah, 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 blah. And you know, sometimes I can see Jonathan's not listening to me at all. And I don't care. I just think, oh, that's so hilarious. He's not listening to me. I wouldn't listen to me either, actually. I'm being quite boring. So you have to up your ante a bit. Not taking everything so seriously and being unchallenging in the way that dogs are. They really don't do that. They don't come and say, oh, I guess they do. They do say, come on, you have to take me out.
Right.
But then that is... that's very life-affirming because you need to get up and walk. You need to get the old circulation going. So they're doing you a huge favor.
But I have to say one thing that I always think about Jonathan and Simon is the sense of humor. I think if you have a sense of humor and you keep things, life is so hard, you keep things funny and respectful and you keep it rolling, a sense of humor will save the day over and over again.
Yes.
I mean, it is
humor and teasing and humor.
Yeah. Like, and letting things go. Like, it's not such a big deal that whatever honey, you're not listening to me. Let it go. You know,
right. And then if they're not listening to you, it's fun to sort of say really insulting things until they realize what you're saying. And then you got their attention again, you
right,
know.
Right. Yeah. Humor is so important.
Yes.
We have another question here. I'm curious what Simon thinks about the future of luxury. There is definitely a shift to online shopping from brick and mortar, but I'm curious if he thinks there is a shift in shopping patterns where less people, especially millennials, are valuing luxury products. And if so, what does that mean for luxury brands?
I can see that kind of shift. But I think there's also, in tandem with that shift, is a growing awareness of luxury products. Like, for example, here, millennials might be thinking more, oh, I want to spend that money on a trip to Iceland when the COVID's over, or experiential things. But cut to China, there's a growing market for luxury. It's probably got quite a few years left in it, though I did read the other day that there's also experiential shift there. I mean, I think it's good. I'm always happy when luxury is kept alive, not because it's prestigious or because it gives you cachet, or just because there are people that make that stuff and it's job creation and it's a particular type of skill to, you know, if you look at a very expensive garment and turn it inside out, and you'll see the hand sewing and tailoring. And I'm a big, we used to do this thing at Barney's called Artisan Day. You know, and people would be like, what the hell's that? And I said, well, these shoes are hand stitched and these shirts are made at this fabulous factory that's been around since the 19th century in Houston, Hamilton Shirts. So, you know, I've been to factories, the Hermes factory, the where Prada gets their ready to wear made, and watching how people work, those Neapolitan tailors, that side of luxury. People should always remember, like, yes, it's about prestige and it's about status, why people buy luxury goods. But there are these armies of people that have these very specific skills. Like in Italy, they can print like 10 colors on silk velvet. You know, that skill has evolved since the Renaissance. So, you know, one wants those kind of skills to be kept alive, and the luxury business keeps those things alive, and it's job creation. So I think there's absolutely the trend towards more experiential thing, but there's still a growing love of luxury as well.
So interesting. Simon, this viewer wants to know, they're interested in your muses. Who are your muses right now?
Let's see, muses. Anybody who's cheeky and funny, like I love Lizzo, she's very funny. I have a good quote from her in my book, and her music's great. And it's very positive messaging, most of it, I think all of it. Who else? And then I could like go back in history. You know, what am I reading? All kinds of crazy stuff. Like, I just read a book about Brian Jones, but he's not very inspirational. He suffered terribly, poor thing. Brian Jones from the Rolling Stones, who drowned in a swimming pool. That's not a good example. So muses, Lizzo and Wendy Goodman and, anybody who's propelling culture forward, you know, like Edward Enninful in London is reinventing the role of Vogue editor in the most fascinating, interesting way. So he's a good example, this fantastic Black guy who's super talented and is now the editor of English Vogue. And so he's doing an extraordinary job. I find him a muse. If by muse you mean a source of inspiration.
All right. Well, that hour pretty much just flew on by, but before we start to wrap things up for the evening, I'd like to ask one more question here. Simon, when readers pick up your book, How to Be Yourself, what is the thing you most want them to take away once they read it from this book?
I most want readers to read my book and be amused and be less self-critical. Because I feel like I'm at war with social media, which forces people to be very self-critical, and especially with young people, creates these terrible ways of insecurity. And so my book is like, I think because I lived in London in the 70s during glam rock and punk rock, and all the girls I knew were absolutely crazy, and they never cared what anybody else thought, and they were completely, they're every bit as crazy and fun and belligerent as the boys. So I want everyone to have that kind of energy, especially when they're young, and not worry about what other people think.
Absolutely, I love it. And what perfect timing, the holidays are upon us. I mean, a book that you can gift to yourself, that you can gift to your friends, to your loved ones, It's stunning in every way and uplifting and heartwarming and just beautiful. So,
well, thank you. And special thanks to Wendy Goodman. Woo woo!
Oh, so happy to see you and be with you. Great honor. Great honor. Congratulations.
And thank you for the blue hat, J'adore.
Okay, well, maybe I'll do it again. You know, who knows?
Well, I do talk in the book about adopting a signature flourish.
Yes, you do. And you do mention hats also.
Yeah, because, you know, they're Zoom-tastic. They're always visible on Zoom.
Well, Simon, Wendy, thank you for allowing us to be with you tonight, for a wonderful conversation, for insight into Simon's new book. And thank you to all of our guests for being with us tonight, joining in on the fun and the conversation. And as always, thank you for supporting your local independent bookstores. It means the absolute world to us.
Yes.
How to Be Yourself, Life-Changing Advice from a Reckless Contrarian is out by Simon Doonan. It is available for purchase at BookHampton, RJ Julia Booksellers, and Wesleyan RJ Julia Bookstore. Get your copies while you can, in-store, over the phone, or online, whatever you are most comfortable with. I wish you all a very happy and safe Thanksgiving. Happy reading all. Have a fantastic night.
Thanks. Good night.